Welcome to Deep Reinforcement Learning. Today you will learn how to employ intelligent behavior in complex dynamic environments. We start with a general introduction to deep reinforcement learning and conclude the first part with an introduction to AlphaGo Zero. In part 2, we implement a basic deep reinforcement learning algorithm using Keras. This is for learning purposes only, because nowadays a lot of the complexity is covered by deep reinforcement learning libraries. Therefore, in the last part, we'll use Ray and RLLib to train a so-called multi-armed bandit with historic market data to create a trading bot. As RLLib uses TensorFlow and PyTorch under the hood, we can deploy the generated TensorFlow model on Watson Machine Learning to serve our users. In reinforcement learning, an agent A interacts with an environment E through a set of discrete or continuous actions. The environment E returns environment state updates S and rewards R. The goal of agent A is to maximize the sum of the rewards. In contrast to supervised learning on static training data, in DeepRL the agents continuously create new training data interacting with the environment. Some algorithms store historic data in so-called replay buffers. Please note that not all environments return a reward after each action. This is called a sparse reward setting, which we will cover later. In this simple example, we can see a CNN fed with frames from a computer game, which outputs a binary class as action. In a supervised setting, training data are image frames plus a binary label for moving up or down. Therefore, we can't get better than humans, since data was generated by humans. In DeepRL, the output of the neural network is used to interact with the computer game. Therefore, the algorithm can come up with action sequences no human ever thought of. In DeepRL, a neural network between input state and output actions is called policy network. Biological neural networks are optimizing a trade-off between exploration and exploitation. Exploitation means you perform an action you know of getting a positive reward, like going to your favorite restaurant. Exploration means you try something new, which most likely doesn't return a high reward, but with a low chance returns an even higher reward. Like going to a new restaurant, which turns out to be even better than your favorite. In DeepRL, this behavior can be simulated with epsilon greedy exploration. Your policy network outputs a policy vector assigning a probability to each action. Exploitation means you just choose the action with the highest probability. Exploration means here that with a probability of epsilon, you take a random action other than that with the highest probability. This way, you ensure that you are not getting stuck in a region of the optimization space. Usually, epsilon decreases over training time, but it turns out that there exist alternative algorithms which perform better. The current state of the art in DeepRL optimization algorithms is proximal policy optimization, also known as PPO. It's now the de facto standard, which has been used by OpenAI 5 defeating the Dota 2 champions. Let's understand AlphaGo Zero. AlphaGo Zero doesn't use any handcrafted features, no handcrafted rewards, and no human training data. This means AlphaGo Zero learns entirely from scratch using self-play only. Note that Go is a perfect information game and we have a perfect simulator, which both we often don't have in real world. Let's dive into the AlphaGo Zero architecture. First of all, as input, we have a board representation of shape 19 by 19 by 17. We have 19 by 19 stones. We have 15 boards in the past. We have one current board. And we have one layer which encodes whether it's the black or white turn. After that, we have a residual convolutional network. And then at the end, a fully connected feature layer. The layer splits where we have a policy vector and a value function. The value is actually giving us a winning probability. This is also used in proximal policy optimization. Let's have a look how AlphaGo Zero is trained. We start in state 1. In state 1, we already have a huge number of possible moves. Each move is branching out a tree. So we need to search all the subtrees for possible outcomes. As we can't do this for all the trees, we use a technology called Monte Carlo tree search. And using the policy vector, we decide which of the actions we actually take. So we only take the n actions with the highest probability. Again, here we are using epsilon greedy exploration, which means that we randomly choose actions with a lower probability. In the case of AlphaGo Zero, we actually choose 1,000 actions per state. It turns out that AlphaGo Zero learned moves which are well known to the Go community. On the x-axis, you see the training time, and on the y-axis, you see the frequency, how often those moves have been used. It turns out that the more complex moves have been used in later training time, but the simpler moves haven't been used anymore. And also, AlphaGo Zero invented moves which haven't been known to the community so far. So currently, the researchers are analyzing which moves AlphaGo Zero came up with. Let's have a look of research consumption of AlphaGo Zero. On the x-axis, you see the time, and on the y-axis, you see the consumption of resources. So you can clearly see that AlphaGo Zero is using a lot of resources. This means AlphaGo Zero was using state-of-the-art deep learning technology, but was excelling at distributed computing. This is why I want to show you Ray, which actually is a perfection of distributed computing. So stay tuned. Let's start with an overview on Ray. Ray in a nutshell. So in a nutshell, Ray is primarily a library, where Spark is primarily a framework. Spark is more about slicing and dicing data, whereas Ray is a universal distributed computing platform. On the top right, you see that Ray is always faster than Spark and Dask. On the bottom left, we see that the resource consumption of the latest deep learning breakthroughs always superseded Moore's law. Therefore, there is a real need of distributed computing platforms. And finally, in the middle, you see that Python is becoming the de facto standard for programming languages in ML and AI. So this made the case for Ray. The Ray architecture is designed to fit distributed deep RL training. It initially was inspired by Dask, but the architecture now finally resembles a universal distributed computing engine. For high-performance zero-copy object store, they use Plasma, which is based on Apache Arrow. The usual worker and driver you already know from Apache Spark, but another difference is the local scheduler, which actually mitigates the bottleneck of the global scheduler of Apache Spark. On top of Ray, you have different libraries. The most prominent is definitely distributed RL, backed by RLLib. But there are other libraries. For example, for distributed training, model serving, streaming, data processing, and hyperparameter search. Because Ray is a universal distributed computing platform. The best choice for using Ray is still distributed RL. Okay, so let's dive into environment simulators. The most famous one is the OpenAI Gym, where you have different Atari games and environment simulators, and we will just start with this one here. This is a really simple simulator. It's called Cardpole, and the only thing what you can do is you can either shift the card to left or right, and the goal is that the pole is not falling. What you always get back is information about the environment, and you basically, as I've already said, you have two actions. So what we now do is, first, we need to install this OpenAI Gym. It's called OpenAI Gym, but I've already done this here, so let's just import the packages. And now what we do is we create the environment. So we specify that we want the Cardpole V1 environment. So this is now generated for us. And now what we do is we create training data. So this is not reinforcement learning. What we want to do is we want to randomly select actions, so left and right, and then only use the successful games for training a deep learning model. Okay, so that's some sort of the first step to understand the material. So this is a function for exactly doing this. So we play a number of games, so in this case 10,000 games. Okay. And the score is of course initially zero. And then we have a number of steps we want to play. So the maximum is 500, but I can tell you that you never ever reach the 500 steps because you will fail before. So the card will basically, the pole will basically fall. But that's just the maximum number, okay? So what we now do is we choose an action. This is either going left or going right, so 0 or 1. And then here we have a pointer to our environment, and we just advance this environment one step. So we issue an action against our environment, and then we get back an observation and also a reward and a flag if we are done. That means if the pole has fallen down. Then, if we have a previous observation, so from the second iteration, we append the previous observation and the action. That's actually interesting because we want to train a deep learning neural network for issuing a specific action based on an observation. And as I said, we are only recording the successful games. Therefore, if a successful game had a previous observation and the action was successful, we just want to append this to our memory. And finally, here we only record games which are successful, so which have at least a specific score. In this case, the score is 60. So again, with random sampling in the action space, this is only, of course, 0 and 1, issuing against the environment, we record observations and actions. And as we only record successful games, we get a training set with observation action pairs, which led to a high reward. Okay, so this is pretty interesting. Let's actually define this function now. And now we can create the training data. So this is now a list, and this list contains, first of all, at the zero index, an array. So this is the observation of the environment. And then this is a successful action, okay? So we are recording observations and successful actions, and therefore we have a training data set for training such a model. Now what we do is we just store this. And as I'm lazy, I was too lazy to transform this nested data set into a pandas data frame. Therefore, I'm just pickling it up. So that means I'm just serializing this list object, and then I'm shooting it up to Cloud Object Store. And as you can see here, we have this training data set now available in Cloud Object Store. So let's actually use the generated training data and train a model to perform the best actions given the observation. So we use TensorFlow 2.3.0 here. I've already installed it. And then we need to import some libraries. Course, we need also to install the OpenAI Gym. It's actually best practice, in my opinion, to have all the imports at the beginning of the notebook. I mean, all the pip installs, then you actually know what you need to install. And what I also usually do is I provide the version number. So we see here it's 0.17.3. And then we are really sure that the API isn't changing and breaks our code. And from now on, we are always using these versions, and that makes us sure that we don't get any problems with changing APIs. Now we can now import those libraries. And then we download this pickled training dataset from the last notebook. So you see here, we have this training data in pickle format. So that's basically a list. We just read this file. Then we have the training data again available. So we are passing data between the notebooks via object store. That's in the cloud a good practice because then the notebooks are transient and not relying on any persistent storage. So let's create the actual model. So this is a deep learning model which uses as input the observation. And you see here, that's the input size. And that should be 4. And then we have a layer with 128 dense neurons and then 52. And then it has output size here as number of neurons, that's 2. And we use mean squared of errors as loss function and Adam as optimizer. So that's our model. I mean, I just came up with this. It works pretty well. You can, of course, improve here as well. So and then we create a function to train the model. So we take the training data and we extract x. So x is basically the first element in that list, which is an array. And this array has basically 4 elements, which is the observation. And then y is the action which we should perform once we are given this observation x. So we are mapping from x to y. So we build the model. Input size is of course here 4. Output size is 2. And then we just say fit x and y for 10 epochs. Okay. And now we call it. So you see here we are training the first epoch. And the loss is constantly decreasing, which is a good sign. Okay, so this training is completed. So we obtained a model here, which we now can use to act against our environment. So what we do again here is we create the cardboard environment, we reset it, and we have a max depth of 500. Let's see whether we reach that goal or not. And then we play 100 games. And I'm just printing out the game ID that we know that something is going on. And then we perform in a range between 0 and 500 steps. Of course, if we are done, that means if the environment says the pole has fallen down, we break before. And then what we do is we, in the first iteration, we just choose a random action. But then we have observation. And the observation then is used here. You see previous observation to predict the next best action. And this action then is just appended for audit purposes only. But what we do is we use the action and we issue this action against the environment. And then what this gives us is a new observation and that we assign to the previous observation for the next iteration. And also we add the reward and let's see how far we get here. So I'm starting this process. And we see here it takes a while. After 100 games, we obtain an average score of over 100, which is pretty good because our games, which we have used to create the training data, had a threshold of 60. So that's actually working out quite nicely. So this is an example how you create training data in advance and use this training data to train an agent. And now we will learn how to do proper deep reinforcement learning by actually having the agent interacting with the environment at the same time and updating weights and learning. So that's a difference because Here we just created the training data, but now the training data will be created on the fly while the agent learns and interacts with the environment. That means the future training data is always dependent on the model which has been trained. So let's stay tuned for that. So now we actually employ real reinforcement learning. Again, we have our standard pip install and inputs. And here I am creating again the card pool environment. I reset and I define that I will train for 10,000 games. So again, I'm here creating our policy network. This is here a simple Keras network, and you know it from the previous section that it has an input shape of four neurons because we have four values for our environment state, and we have two output neurons because we have a left and right action, and again mean squared of errors as loss function and Adam as optimizer. So if we now test this neural network with an arbitrary environment state, then you see that we get more or less random distribution of action probabilities back. So 50% chance of going left and 50% chance of going right. So let me start this cell because training takes quite a while. And let me walk you through the code. By the way, I'm now here training in a runtime environment which has 30 CPU cores. But I can also, for example, run on an environment which has four GPUs. And therefore, I have put the GPU code for TensorFlow, which you need to put for multiple GPU training inside this notebook that you can also play around with it. Okay, so what I'm doing here is relatively similar to the data generator loop, but in contrast to the data generator loop, I'm already using the observations to train my policy network. So here, for this 10,000 games, I'm looping through. Here, in the first iteration, I do a random action, and this is my observation and my reward. And now I'm actually starting to play. So I'm asking my policy network, based on the observation, what the policy network recommends me to do. So this is the policy. And then I've already explained this. This is epsilon greedy exploration. If my probability of using the policy is below 0.0005, then I'm actually using the policy. Otherwise, I'm creating a random action. Okay, so this is my action. And I'm now running this action against the environment. And I'm pending the observation action to the game memory. Because I want to decide whether I use the outcome of the game for further training the policy network or not. I'm doing this only if I'm in a reward setting greater than 60. Let's have a look how this works. So this is also similar to the training data generator. If the score of the whole game was above 60 in this case, then I added the data to the training data. In this case, I'm not adding the data to the training data, I'm training the policy network. That means if I have a successful game, then I'm directly training the policy network. And in the next iteration, I'm using the policy network to create my next set of actions. Okay, as you can see here, there's no training data involved. The training data is generated on the fly, and the policy network is actually defining what data is generated because the policy network always tells me which action I have to take. And based on the action, I'm interacting with the environment and I'm getting back an observation and a reward. And this leads to further changes in the model. Okay, that's the whole difference here. And this takes quite some time, but after 10,000 iterations, we should see improvement in the score. So while this agent is training on 30 cores, now we see that here at the green status, I can in parallel open a second notebook and I've assigned only one core to that one. And this is now creating a pod on the IBM Kubernetes service with only one core. And we just need to wait until this happened. By the way, the technology behind that is open source and it's called the Jupyter Enterprise Gateway, which enables you to use Kubernetes as an execution environment for your notebooks, which is pretty cool. So again, I have my pip install in the first cell of the notebook, and I will here install Ray 0.8.4 because I am having some issues with version 1. So this already happened. Just to be on the safe side, I'm restarting the kernel. So let's import Ray. And I'm here working on a local Ray instance. And just to show you how Ray works. So in Ray, you can annotate functions and they become a remote function. So I have here a regular function which returns 1. And then I can annotate a function here. And of course, if I call the regular function, I get back 1. If I call a remote function, I get back a function pointer. And if I say Ray get that function pointer, I'm getting back this number here. Okay. So there's also a way to create remote actors by annotating a whole class with Ray remote, but that's just to show you a bit how Ray works. Afterwards, we will use rllib, which encapsulate all that distribution complexity for us. So that's pretty cool. So now let's actually start cooking. Again, we will install Ray 0.84, which is already here in this pod. And we need some other dependencies which didn't get resolved properly. We need also OpenCV for whatever reason. This is just another dependency which doesn't get resolved by the Ray installer. While this runs, I just show you what else we need to install. Again, we need to install Jim and also TensorFlow. But actually, what we do later in this notebook, we will push the trained agent to Watson Machine Learning, and currently only version 1.15 is supported. But that doesn't matter because Ray completely encapsulates the deep learning frameworks. So for certain algorithms, it's using TensorFlow. For certain algorithms, it's using Torch or PyTorch. So you just need find out, but it tells you what libraries are missing. But I just put those here for you. Also, in case you're running this notebook outside Watson Studio, then you need to install those libraries to access the data. So what we are doing here is basically training a trading bot or an agent based on historic market data. So the historic market data I've already preloaded. So it is residing in Cloud Object Store. So it's a daily price for Bitcoin versus US dollar since 2014. the Dow Jones since 2014, IBM and Volkswagen, a German car manufacturer, all since 2013, 14. So those are the daily closing values. And I got this data from Yahoo Finance. You can just download it there. And I've just downloaded it and uploaded it here to the object store. And in the notebook, I'm just grabbing the data. So let's see whether OpenCV is installed now. Looks good. So just double check if this is the case. Okay, then of course we need to install the OpenAI Gym. And then finally, we need to install TensorFlow 1.15. So this will also take some time. Let's walk you further through this notebook. So I have a list of assets I'm trading against. So this is the Dow Jones, Bitcoin, IBM, and Volkswagen. And I'm just reading each CSV file and then joining them together. So afterwards, it looks like this. So I have the date, and then I have the daily value of those assets. Let's double check TensorFlow is installed already. Looks nice. No, still installing. You see here the star. That means the cell is still executing. Let's continue. So once I have all the market data in the pandas data frame, I can start to create a so-called multi-arm bandit. So this is a very simple version of reinforcement learning. You can imagine a single-arm bandit where you just have a slot machine and you pull the arm and you either win or lose. And if you have a multi-arm bandit, it depends which slot machine you are actually using and also the sequence of the slot machines you are using. And that's exactly how such deep reinforcement learning problems can be modeled. So we are here creating a class market bandit, and then we are extending it from OpenAI Gym. So this means we are creating our own environment. If you remember before, we had this card pool environment where we had functions to interact with or methods to interact with, and that's actually the same what we are doing here. So we have here a constructor and we have the reset method and we have the step method, and that's actually all we need. I have some other methods implemented which I'll show you later, but that's actually how you can model such a problem. You can create a multi-armed bandit as a OpenAI environment, and then out of the box it is compatible with Ray. So let's restart this kernel here and just make sure that we are all on the same page regarding the libraries. So let's see what versions we have. Okay, that looks nice. So let's load the market data. I don't walk you through the code, it's pretty obvious, but of course I share the code with you. So here you have the market data. We have 1498 days. So a couple of days didn't have valid data in it, so I just dropped those rows. Actually, it's a bit more what you have in data since 2014, but still fine, 1500 rows. And now we define this market bandit. Okay, so let's have a look at the constructor. In the constructor, you see that we define an action space. Okay, that means we have nine possible actions to do, and that's actually the following. We can say action zero is doing nothing, action one to four is buy something, and five to nine is sell something. And the amount where we buy or sell something, I set to constant 100. And that means if the action is one, we sell something from asset one. So asset one is Dow Jones, for example. Okay. And if the action is 5, for example, then we sell, sorry, then we buy Dow Jones, okay? So, no, sorry, we sell Dow Jones, okay? We also need to define the observation space. The observation space is some sort of the dimensionality of the environment state we return back. In this case, this is just one-dimensional. Here, I'm also assigning the data frame. This is our market data. And then here, the portfolio is giving me the actual amount of the different assets I have purchased. Okay, so I'm creating here a dictionary from the keys of our assets. That means I have here a dictionary, a Python dictionary, and the keys are the asset names. And in there, I assign or I initialize those with 0.0. And afterwards, I can just buy and sell, and then this portfolio gets updated. Here, I'm having a constant. As I already said, it's $100 per step. And each day, I'm allowed to either buy or sell something for $100 or do nothing. Okay, and I'm just double checking the money I've invested. Also, I need to reset this environment, so I need to set everything to zero, especially the index of the data frame, because I'm stepping forward the data frame in one day steps later. Here I have a convenience method implemented to get the current sum of the portfolio value using the actual portfolio values per asset and also multiplying it by the current value. And then I'm summing this up, then I have the complete portfolio value. So now the step is a bit more interesting. So if I'm done, then I just set reward to zero. But otherwise, I'm just checking the index. So that's the actual step and setting the current row to that index. So this is the row containing the asset values at a specific date. And then I'm just saying, storing the portfolio value before I have done something, before I have done any trades. And now I need to read out the action. So the action can be between 0 and 9, and I need to check out what I need to do. If the action is 0, I do nothing. That is, of course, giving me also 0 reward. But otherwise, I need to check out whether I'm buying or selling. So I set buy to false first, and if the action is below 5, the 0 case is already covered. This means if the action is between 1 and 5, sorry, 1 and 4, then it means I want to buy something and I set buy to true. And then I select the asset to trade, and the asset to trade I can also derive from the action, because for example, if the action is 4, then the asset to trade has index 3, and index 3 is the Volkswagen asset, so it's 0, 1, 2, 3 Volkswagen. Okay, so that way, based on the action, I know what I want to trade. And the same holds for selling, just I need to play around with the index. So I know the asset to trade, and I know whether I want to buy or sell. So now I need to get the price. So the price for the asset is also easy to obtain. I have the current row, which contains all the asset prices for that particular day, and I know the asset to trade, so I get the price for the asset. And then I can just check out what fraction of the asset I can sell or buy, because 100 bucks is of course less than all the asset prices here, so I can also buy a fraction or sell a fraction of the asset. And that's actually something I'm computing here. And in case I'm buying, then I know that I can update the portfolio value for the asset I'm buying plus the fraction I'm trading. And of course, I need to increase the amount of the money I've invested. That's for later analytics. Otherwise, if I'm selling, I'm just subtracting this value. So after my trading, I get the portfolio value after trading, and then I'm computing the reward. So that's I'm just normalizing it here. So that's the portfolio value after minus the portfolio value before. So that's actually the wins I'm making. And here I'm just incrementing the index. So I'm stepping one day more into the future. And if I'm at the end, I'm saying done true, then I know that the trading data is over. So I'm returning the reward and also the done flag, and that's basically it. Okay, so let's execute this. What I now can do is I can instantiate this bandit and I can just randomly take actions. So I can sample the action space. So what you see here is the action. If the action is zero, then I'm getting back a certain reward and it's not done. This is false. Okay, so let's scroll down a bit. So now I'm actually training. This means I need to initialize Ray. And I'm now using the PPO trainer. I've already covered this. PPO stands for Proximal Policy Optimization, and that's the latest state of the art in deep reinforcement learning. So very happy that this is provided by RLLib for us here. I need to set some configuration and then I can actually start to train. So I'm just training for 20 iterations. And I'm seeing here dots for the iterations. Okay, so this is done. So I have now trained my policy network. Now let's actually simulate it. So what I'm doing here, I'm using the policy network to compute an action based on a state. And then I'm using this action against the environment and I'm getting a reward. And I'm summing up this reward. And you see here that it's actually working quite well. So for around $75,000 I've invested, I'm making a return of nearly half a million. So let's actually do one thing. Now I have created an agent, which of course everybody on this planet wants to use. So I need to make it servable. And I'm using Watson Machine Learning here. So what I can do is I can use Trainer and I can export the model. Since this is backed by TensorFlow, I'm obtaining a TensorFlow saved model. Let me just show that to you. So you see here, if it ends with PB, then it's most likely a TensorFlow saved model. I can also reload this model later, so I can use it in other program code, and you've already learned how to store stuff on object store, so this is pretty straightforward. And now what I'm doing is I'm rereading this model. Okay, so I have now save this model, and what I'm doing now is I'm creating an instance of Watson Machine Learning. So here I'm getting a reference back to the client. No worries, before I publish this, I will change this API keys. And I need to tell what's machine learning that I'm using TensorFlow 1.15 and some other properties. And I need to tell what's machine learning in which space I want to deploy, just for completeness. So I have different spaces here in Watson Studio, and in the spaces I have models, and these models I can deploy. We will see that later. It's just a way to organize things. So I'm now storing the model, but actually give it a new name. Okay, now I have stored this model in this space. So let's actually refresh this page. See, this is the one I just deployed right now. The cool thing is I just can click on the deploy button. I create an online service. This means I can call it via REST. If I now go to deployments, you see here it's in progress. Take a while, and it will push this model to Kubernetes via Knative, and it's already deployed. I click on this deployment. Then you see here the URL under which this model is available, and also some code for different programming languages on how to use it is provided. And Kubernetes and Knative is actually taking care of scaling the model. Okay, that was the lab. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, just ping me and I'm happy to answer.